So over the next 5 weeks, we're doing something called Frontline Sundays. This is a series which was put together by the London Institute of Contemporary Christianity, which is an organization which helps churches and helps individuals with how they live out their faith in the modern world. They're really, really helpful. I'd recommend going to their website and finding out about them. As part of this series, there's going to be little video clips every week just to kind of introduce what we're talking about. This week, it's the first one, and it's getting us to think about how we can make all the difference in the world. Thanks, Luke.
Over a month, around 6% of the UK gather together to worship Jesus.
It feels like we're too few to make a difference.
But the reality is, Monday to Saturday, God has us, scattered in the world, connecting to hundreds and thousands of people.
So wherever you are,
whoever you are,
whatever you do,
you can make all the difference in the world.
And on Sundays, when we gather together,
we strengthen and empower one another to be sent out again
for life on our front lines.
They're not long video clips, but they do say something to us. I wonder how many of us, as you watched that, thought, does my life make a difference? Or the purpose of gathering is to empower us to go out to do things for Jesus again. This is what we're going to be looking at over the next 5 weeks. And this is all about how we can make a difference for Jesus wherever it is we have been placed, whatever it is we do. That when we gather together, part of the function of us gathering and being here together, part of it is to worship God. Yeah, that's part of why we're here. But another part is to mutually inspire one another and encourage one another for what we've got to do between Sunday and the next Sunday, for our Monday to Saturday life. It's not that, we gather for two purposes, to worship God and to empower one another to do the things Jesus would want us to do. As we begin this, what I'm going to do though is I'm going to talk briefly about a missionary from the 1800s, 1900s, a man called C.T. Studd. There he is up on the screen looking particularly 1800s. I think that's fair to say. He looks like he's from that era. He was originally a cricketer. He played in the very first test series, which gave birth to the Ashes. But he left all of his potential fame and all of the potential fortune he might have got from being a cricketer to become a missionary. He was a man with a startling and incredible faith. He had strong opinions about what Christians should do and what they shouldn't do, and whether you like him or not, you can't disagree with the fact that he put his money where his mouth was. So when he received his inheritance, bear in mind this is the late 1800s, of £29,000, which I can only assume must have been an absolute fortune in those days, he gave every single penny of it away and devoted his life to being a missionary. Of his work, and he worked in various countries all around the world, he said this: "Some want to live within the sound of a church bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell." He devoted pretty much every minute of his life trying to share the message of Jesus with people. He also wrote quite a famous poem. He wrote this, the poem, "Only One Life, 'Twill Soon Be Past." And the reason for mentioning him this morning is just to look at the words of this poem for a second, because in it he writes this: "Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last." What I'd like you to do is to take a moment and to kind of breathe in those words. I wonder what you make of them. They are stark. They are clear. They remind us that one day, each and every one of us stands before God, our lives get evaluated, and all that we did that had eternal value will be shown to us. Some things will last and some things won't. Now think about this. How do those words make you feel about what you're doing tomorrow? As you picture yourself going to work, as you perhaps picture yourself working on a spreadsheet, because that's what I used to do, so that's what I think people do at work, or you picture yourself driving a bus or teaching children, or perhaps as you look at tomorrow, you think, I've got no particular plan at all. How do those words make you feel if you're looking back on your working life and you're retired? How do they make you feel if you're at the beginning of your career? How do they make you feel? My guess is, for some in the room, those words are inspiring. They make us want to try great things for God, to reorientate our lives so that we're doing more for Him. But for others, perhaps even a majority, which might just be a little bit too scared to vocalize it, I think those words can strike at our hearts and get us thinking, have I wasted my time? Am I wasting my time? Is what I do each and every day a waste? Should I be doing something full-time for God? Am I disappointing God each and every day I get up? However you respond to that poem by C.T. Studd, the series that we're beginning to look at today and the small groups that go along with it can speak to us all. If you feel that what you do between Sunday and the next Sunday doesn't have any point or purpose in God's plan, hopefully by the end of this 5 weeks, you're going to see that God has purposes for us every single day. That you don't have to travel the world to do something which echoes into eternity, but we can do it wherever God has placed us. Because I reckon if you felt a little bit disturbed by those words up on the screen, you're probably not alone. Because in the video, it talked about some facts about Christians. Here's some more. So 98% of Christians are not involved in full-time Christian work. I think that's fair to say. 98% of Christians don't work full-time for churches and things. Of those 98% of people, 95% of their time they spend away from other Christians and with people who aren't Christians. Amongst the population, only 6% of people in the UK go to church at least once a month. That's describing the average Christian experience. And as true as the statement is, it's only what we do for Christ that will last, it does beg the question, what counts as something done for Christ? What counts as something done for Christ? Is it only things done in church? Is it only when you share your faith with people? Is it only when you're part of a ministry like Junior Church or Gang of Disciples or so on? Or does your work count? Does your life count? Does how you raise your children count? Does how you relate to your neighbours as you walk past them on the street count? Does it all count, or are 98% of us wasting our time? That's what the next 5 weeks are about. And we're going to kick off this series by reminding ourselves of something. We're going to answer a couple of questions. We're going to answer the question, who are we and what are we for? And in that little reading from 1 Peter, we're told something. So if you do have the Bible, have 1 Peter 1 open. We're told in those first couple of verses that Christians are God's chosen people, set apart with a God-given purpose, living in a world where we don't completely belong. That's who we are. We're God's chosen people, set apart with a God-given purpose, living in a world where we don't completely belong. We're a people who believe that the world is broken because of sin, but also because of Jesus and his sacrifice. One day everything will be made new. That's what we thought about last week. But that's who we are on the screen. God's chosen people, set apart for a purpose, living in a world where we don't belong. And so this morning, we're going to break that down into two sections. We are a chosen people with a purpose on the one hand, and we're outsiders who don't quite fit in on the other. We're going to look at that before we think about how we're supposed to live in the light of it. So, if you've got 1 Peter chapter 1 open, those first couple of verses are packed with a load of stuff. It talks about how we're chosen by God according to his foreknowledge, his ability to know everything that happens before it happens, that we're sanctified by the Holy Spirit, that we're sprinkled by the blood of Jesus. There's things in there which could make us go, what? What is all that talking about? And for centuries, people have argued about these couple of verses, about what it means. Whole denominations have been formed over disagreements about these couple of verses. What I'd like us to do is take it as one flow, take it as one thing, to see what the Father, Son, and the Spirit have done, rather than go into the microscopic detail of what each particular word means. So when it talks about how we are chosen, here's the big thing to take away from that. Not one single Christian became a follower of Jesus entirely by their own intellect or ability. Not one Christian who comes to faith did so at their own initiative. Every single one of us has been drawn by God, and God has said over each and every one of us, I'm having them, I want them, I'm setting them apart. That's what this verse is saying. You've been chosen by God for a purpose. Not one of us was more pious or godly or morally superior to anyone else, but we were set apart by God's grace. We were chosen to receive his mercy. We were made part of his family. Now, we're always tempted to peer behind that, to try and fathom out what's going on, to try and work out God's reasoning. Maybe, though, it's just one of those things we're supposed to read and put our questions to one side and say thank you about. Not try and work out what's going on, but to think, God's chosen me. He's made me part of his family. Maybe we're supposed to say to God, I thank you that for some unfathomable reason, you've made me and everyone in this church part of your family. You've blessed us when we didn't deserve it. You've made us a people for your purpose. I think that's what we're supposed to do. And we're also supposed to hold it in tension with things that Jesus says, where he says things like this, whoever comes to me, I'll never turn away. We're supposed to hold those two things together. We are chosen for a purpose. And the very next part of the phrase just builds on this. When it says, chosen according to the foreknowledge of the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, again, an odd phrase for us, it's talking about how we changed. And it's how God, by his Spirit, has picked us and made us part of his people. When it talks about there, about the sanctifying work of the Spirit, it's not talking about a process that you go through in life, even though there is a work of the Spirit where you change through life. It's saying God has picked you, and he set you apart, and he's given you a purpose. And the purpose, next part of the verse, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood. What we might not see in these couple of verses is an echo of an ancient event from the Old Testament. In the book of Exodus, once the people have crossed into the wilderness, once they've been to Mount Sinai and God's given them the Ten Commandments, there's a moment where God meets with Moses on the mountain, and there's smoke and fire and all of that sort of stuff. And the people go to where Moses is, and there's a ceremony. So in Exodus 24, there's a ceremony where the people respond to what God has done. They make a load of sacrifices. God gives them his laws and tells them how to live. Moses reads out all the laws of the Old Testament, and the people say, we will obey, just like 1 Peter says. And then Moses sprinkles the blood on them. It's a moment when God says to them, I will be your God. And the people say, we will be your people and we will do what you say. Same things happen to us. God has made us his people and he's saying to us, hey, if you're going to be my people, you have to do what I say. Back then, God's people were chosen to be a blessing to the world. Their response was to say, we'll obey. And they sealed the deal with this sprinkled blood. Same thing has happened to us. albeit we don't see it. But if you're a Christian, part of it, part of becoming a Christian was you saying to God, I will do what you say. I will follow you. And we were sprinkled with the blood of Jesus' sacrifice. God has chosen you. He set you apart for a purpose. He has said, I'll be your God. He wants us to be his people. And Jesus has made this possible. Part of the deal is that we're supposed to walk in it. That's what we're supposed to do. We are people called with a purpose. So if you feel that you don't count at the moment, that's who you are. You're someone called by God with a purpose. There's something else in these couple of verses in 1 Peter, though. There's another verse. One of the things Peter calls them is exiles. Exiles. And when Peter was writing, he was writing to a group of people who were scattered around a particular area. There's all different kinds of cities mentioned. And so when he says the word exile, he might be talking about people that have had to be scattered because of persecution and so on. But actually, there's something else in the mix as well. Exiles are people who live somewhere where they don't properly belong. That's what we're like as well. We live somewhere where we don't completely belong, where the values that God gives to us don't mesh with the world that we live in, where there will be ways that we think that the world around us doesn't think is right. And by using the word exile, we're supposed to think of an incredible challenge God gave to his people in the past, when they'd been taken from the promised land and taken over to Babylon, to a foreign land and a foreign culture full of foreign gods and different teachings and other ways of living and different practices. They had to work out how to live as God's people in a place where they didn't belong, to be a blessing to those people and to still be faithful to God. That's the path we have to walk as well. But it is not easy. When you live in a culture, you start to pick up the thoughts and the processes and the values of that culture. I've got a friend. I haven't seen him for years, but we grew up in the same church. I'm going to be honest, he had a bit of a posher accent than me. He used to go to the Anglican church before coming to the Baptist church, and so he spoke properly. He was had a proper English voice and everything. He pronounced everything properly, all of the syllables. It was all perfect. He was unmistakably British. But he married an American girl, and he moved out to the States, and he became a pastor out there. And when the pandemic hit, like we did, that all of their services went online, and his did. And one day, out of pure curiosity, I decided to listen in to my well-spoken British friend living in the south of America. And I was really surprised, because this person who was like someone off of Radio 4 sounded like someone out of the Dukes of Hazzard. It was bizarre. There was not a single trace of his accent left. It was proper Forrest Gump kind of voice. It was bonkers. Now, whether that was a deliberate choice on his part to fit in with the people around him, I don't know. But something had happened. He'd lived in that culture and he'd picked up all of the tones of voice, all of the inflections. It happens. It happens. I've noticed how Lawns now says hooge and not huge. Lawns says hooge. Listen out for it. She does it all of the time. And now that's just speech. That's just speech. When you're totally immersed in a culture, you pick up all kinds of things. You pick up its values. And if those values diminish how well you walk with Christ, or they make you do a 180 on your commitment to him, then you're not living the life you were set apart to live. Each one of us lives in a world where we don't quite fit in because of our faith. It's going to make a difference. It's going to make a difference. And we have to walk the same tightrope that the people who went to Babylon had to walk. Started off that video, and there was a couple of pictures. There was a picture of the gathered church together and then the scattered church out in the community. I want you to think about what happens if you only live one of those pictures, if you only live one of them. So what's my next slide, Luke? Because I can't remember what order I did these in. Yeah. So if you just only gather with church people and you're not really involved in the community and you don't have any friends outside of church, what's going to happen to that church community over time? It's going to get smaller because we won't interact with people and we will naturally get smaller because we age and we drop off. That's what happens if we just live in a world where we only do church things. What about if we do the other? What if we only ever have ourselves scattered amongst the culture? If we never gather together, what's going to happen then? Our distinctiveness is going to diminish too, because we'll be discipled by the world around us. So the red dots, which stand for Christians in that picture, will start to become a little bit more grey. We won't be all that we should be. What we need to be, and what we're going to look at over the next few weeks, is we need to have a kind of cycle of gathering together to then scatter. To gather together to be built up and to be encouraged and to hear more about Jesus, so that when we're scattered into the world, we take Jesus with us and we have an influence on those around us. That's what we're called to do. If we just stay here, we shrink. If we just go out there, we'll become just like everyone else. We need to do both. Gather to scatter. That's what the next 5 weeks are about. So how do you find the sweet spot? How do you find the way to walk the tightrope in the world that we live in? Well, thankfully, God gave some instructions. When his people were exiled off to Babylon and they were going to be living there for 70 years, some of those folks were going to be born there, live there, and die there, living in a world where their faith didn't fit with the culture. And God told them how to live. God told them how to live. So if you've got the Bible open, Jeremiah 29. What God said to those people back then holds true for us today. So I'm just going to read them again, those words again. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have called you, to which I've carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Just as a start off, look at verses 5 and 6. Build houses, settle down, plant gardens, eat, marry, procreate, increase in number. In short, make yourself a life in the place where you don't fit in. Don't retreat into a huddle. Don't cut yourself off from everything, but live. And it's quite normal, isn't it? Build houses, settle down, plant gardens, eat. God says to people who live in a world where they don't fit, live in that world. That's what he tells us to do. And then comes verse 7. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I've carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. That little phrase, seek the peace and prosperity, is translating one Hebrew word, and it's the word shalom. It's the word we often take as just meaning peace. But in the Bible, peace isn't quite big enough. It's a big concept. It's all about flourishing in every conceivable way. It's about society, and it's about people. It's about people's mental health and their social health. It's about finance and spirituality and artistically and culturally and ecologically. It's an all-pervasive term. God's people were put into that place to make it flourish in every conceivable way, to make the places where they live their lives better, and to be a blessing. And that is as remarkable today as it was back then. God was saying to the original people who received that letter, you know those folks who ransacked your home and destroyed your temple and dragged you to where you now are? And you have to work for them. Seek their very best. That's what he said. Pray that where you are prospers. Pray for the place which doesn't share your values, which doesn't follow your God. Pray for it. Pray that it prospers. That's how God's people, called with a purpose in a world where they don't fit, are called to live. So thinking about where we began this morning, and your Monday morning, and your week, what are you supposed to do? Whether that's a workplace, whether it's a social club, whether it's a classroom, what are you supposed to do? What are you supposed to do for the people that you meet? You're supposed to try and make it flourish. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to pray for the people that we know we'll encounter. We're building homes, we're building a life, but when we encounter people, we're trying to make that place flourish. God has placed you in your workplace for a reason. There are certain people only you will meet. God wants you there for a reason. If you're retired and you're on the golf tee, God's put you there for a reason. I shouldn't say that with Steve and Jill in the room, because Jill's probably thinking, no, God hasn't placed him on the tee. But as Steve is there, lining up the tee, his tee shot on the first hole, God wants him to be a blessing to the people he's with. He can do something there that no one else can do. In your classrooms, in your homes, you can do things for God. As you chat to your neighbors, you can be a blessing to them. You don't all have to give up your work and go full-time as a missionary. You can do things for God in the places that he has placed you. And that's what the next few weeks are going to be us thinking about. We can make all the difference in the world. So just be encouraged by that. Whatever you're doing tomorrow, God's got a purpose for you there. And so as we do close, what I'd like you to do is think about your week ahead. Whether you're at school, whether you're at work, whether you're retired. Think about what's going to happen this week. Who you might meet. The situations that you encounter. And I'd like us all to silently pray something. To pray this: God, show me how you want me to make an impact in the places you have put me. Because I believe you have placed me there. Because God has placed you there. To say to God that I know I don't fit, and there are things that I find difficult about the world I live in, but you've put me here to make it flourish. To maybe ask Jesus, how can you be a blessing this week? To ask him to place on your heart someone who needs to flourish, whose life needs changing by what you only you can do. For us as a church, perhaps we need to pray this, that God would reveal to us how we can make this place and this town better. So earlier on when we talked about the warm space, that's maybe something you could do. That's something God might want you to do. And it might be all you ever do is smile at someone and serve them a cup of tea. You don't know how God might be using that moment. Let's ask that God will show us, whoever we are, at whatever point of life we're at, that he has purposes for us. That together and individually, we can do something which perhaps we never see the ultimate impact of, but which makes an incredible difference. The reason when the kids were in here earlier talked about the story of Naaman, as Michael so rightly said, that story starts with a little girl living in a world where she doesn't fit, seeking to be a blessing to the person who's ripped her from her home and taken her to work for him as a slave. What she does changes the life of a soldier and impacts the life of a king. Who knows what you can do simply by who you interact with tomorrow? You have a purpose. You've been set apart for it. Let's walk in it. Let's pray. Father God, we would ask this morning that if we're someone who looks at our life and we say things like, I don't have a purpose, I don't fit, I've got nothing to do, that your word says, that's not true. You've been set apart for a purpose and there are things for you to do. Help us to walk in what you've called us to. Help us to not fall into the traps of only gathering together with other Christians and never gathering together with Christians. Help us to see that gathering together is really important because it inspires us and empowers us to do what we're doing in the week. Help us to be your people in the places where you've put us. And Lord, we ask that this week you would give us an opportunity to be a blessing to someone, that you might lay someone on our hearts whose life we can touch. We might be the only Christian they meet. Give us an opportunity to be a blessing to them, practically, socially, culturally, spiritually. And if we get an opportunity to speak about our faith, then Lord, help us to take it. But Lord, would we be a blessing in the places you've put us? And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final song this morning is one we can make as a prayer to God. It's about offering our life up to Jesus for him to use however he sees fit.
Worship to you in surrender. I must.
So as we finish this morning, I'd just like you to think about tomorrow and what you've got to do. And it might be that you're going to read a book to a child at night. It might be that you're going to be working in an office. It might be like Steve, you're firing a golf ball down a fairway. Whatever it is you're doing, God can use you in that place to do something incredible and remarkable. What counts? Potentially anything. Anything you do can count for God, ultimately, and can echo into eternity. As we close, we're just going to have one final prayer, and it's going to be on the screen, and it's something for, is it not? It is. I'm just checking with Luke. It's going to be on the screen, and this is our kind of closing prayer as we step into another week. Is it up there? Cool. We're going to read it together. I'm going to join you so I can see it. So we're going to read this together. Okay, this feels weird. It feels weird looking this way, but here we go. So let's pray. Thank you, Father God, that we are your church, the body of Christ in the world. We're grateful for our Sunday life and the worship that equips us for the days when we're apart. Help us see afresh the possibilities of our everyday lives. May we know your presence with us in the pressures and the potentials of the week. Help us to leave traces of grace wherever we are and whatever we do. Amen. Amen.